Tonight's going to be a little heavier. This is the third message in talking about holidays. We did Easter and Christmas. Christmas I'm a little more lax on. Easter I'm a little more strong on. Tonight is going to be a little heavy. So maybe we should start with prayer. Lord, in Jesus' name, thank you for your word. Thank you for the principles of your word. Thank you for your spirit and the enlightenment of your spirit. We're asking that by the Holy Spirit who lives in us and works among us, that spiritual discernment is given to this presentation. Not just becoming a point of argument of who thinks what's right, what's wrong, and that realm. We want spiritual input to take place with us here tonight and with everybody who sees and views this. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Amen. So let's jump in. Halloween is kind of an interesting subject to have a session on at a church, you know, and talk about should Christians be celebrating at what, you know, etc. Because from my view of it, it has no godly significance whatsoever. You know, Thanksgiving does, Christmas does, Resurrection Sunday does. You look at these others, they do. Halloween is absolutely without godly significance. So it's actually kind of a interesting thing that we even have to talk about it. I am going to take a very strong stance tonight on things. This one I'm going to be really strong on. As a minister, my job is to encourage and exhort and correct and rebuke, and I might be more on the back end of those four tonight. To me, celebrating Halloween is spiritual adultery. It's like a married couple, one of them going and sleeping with someone else as physical adultery, and we'd look at that and go, that's just wrong. Celebrating Halloween is the same thing to God. To me, it's absolute spiritual adultery. And again, it's something you have to decide if you want to, where you stand on it, what you're going to do with it. But to me, it's that serious, so that's why I'm going to take a strong stand on it. I celebrated Halloween as I was growing up. I think everybody who was doing it was just plain ignorant to it. And the scripture talks about people who sin in ignorance, and how God looks at that doesn't mean it's not sin. It's just God views it different. When you're just ignorant to it, he views it different. Once you understand and you realize, now there's a different way that God looks at it. And I grew up, you know, celebrating it. I was 29 or 30 years old when I switched my position on it and celebrating it and so forth, made the official stance, okay, this is it, I'm switching on this. So my objective is to give you some information to think about, give you why I take this strongest stance. And to understand why I take this strongest stance, you're going to have a little bit more understanding of me. Things that are, we do have a Halloween booklet, I've got some up here at the front, that lays out more of the facts, but it's not going to give an understanding of me. So to really understand why in the world would he take that strong stand on it, you have to understand me a little bit. So let me give you a little bit of my background. I grew up on a farm in North Dakota, western side of North Dakota. We were into grain and beef cattle and that world. That was our farm. And I was the last of four children. My personality one was that I was the jokester of the class. Everything was to be had fun with. Nothing was serious. It was live it up, enjoy life. I was pretty much a goof off. The proof of that is the worst grade I ever got on my report card. They used to grade you A, B, C, D, and F. The worst, I've never gotten an F on my report card growing up, but the worst grade I got is they used to have a column called conduct. For those of you who are old or older, I got a D minus in conduct and a few D's because I was just the goof off, man. Anything that you could take and turn and run with it, it didn't make any difference if you were in school or not. You turn and run with it. If you got a laugh out of it from your friends, it was worth it. You know, it's just the way it went. So that was my whole grade school my whole grade school thing. My parents used to laugh when I became an adult. The teachers finally figured out that the way to control me was to let my parents know what I was doing. Other than that, it was free-for-all. And they figured that out when I was a fourth, fifth grader, because, you know, I'm just giving you where I came from. I was just a little holy terror, because everything was just to be had fun with. Life was a game, man. Let's live it up and enjoy this. And the fifth grade teacher was fit to be tied with me. Couldn't figure out what in the world, how can I control this? To the point, they discussed it among the teachers when the teachers had a meeting. And my fourth grade teacher said, oh, that's easy to solve. Just call his mother. And she did. And from there, I had a reason to contain. It was back in the years when, parents' discipline, little law came down, and I had a reason to contain. But that was kind of my personality. That's who I was. I'm embarrassed now to look at some of the old videos. My parents took, you know, the old videos, non-sound, but the video camera. And if I knew that thing was pointing my direction, man, I just acted like an idiot, you know, and laugh, and, you know, it was just good times. That's all I was doing. It's my personality. Between my freshman and sophomore years in high school, that changed. It all came about, I did something that actually wasn't too bright. I've done a few of those things in my lifetime. But between my freshman and sophomore year, I wanted to do an experiment because I had heard that, you know, you can stay up for a length of time and your body starts feeling different, this, that. And yeah, I wanted to experience this. What is this going to be like? So after I got out of school as a freshman, we always worked cattle then that first week or two so we could get them out to the pastures. As well as, that's back when they did the half summer fallow, half crop. So we had a lot of ground to work at the same time for the farming end. We had cattle to work to get them out to the field. So I decided this is a good time to do this. And I don't know how I got this past my parents. They let me do it. Maybe God was in it. And he wanted me to go through this, or I don't know, because they let me do it. But we started like a Monday morning. We worked cattle all day. And then I worked in the field all night till Tuesday morning. And then we worked cattle all day. And then I worked on the field all night. And I did that. The whole thing ended up, I was awake approximately 72 hours before I went to sleep. And the result of that was I wore my body down. So I picked up bronchitis. And it was a severe case of bronchitis. I picked it up beginning of June, and I didn't get free of it until in December. It finally left me. They took me to the doctor, and, of course, there was no big cure back then, but penicillin, you know, they give you penicillin. If that didn't work, they had nothing else. They took me to doctor through two, three times. He said he's just going to have to work his way through it and get over it. And it was really, I couldn't exert myself at all, and I would start, it would block off my bronchial tubes, and I would start hacking and coughing and couldn't get air until I absolutely did nothing. Then it would open enough so I could breathe and get enough air for that. But if I ran from that door and back, I'd be hacking for the next 5 minutes. I couldn't get air. It just would constrict. Well, it was a night my parents were gone. They had gone on vacation to see my sisters who were living in Ohio, and I was home. My brother and his wife were living on the farm, and I was home. And since we were all together, they decided to spend the night in Mom and Dad's house where I was at, spend the nights there while Mom and Dad were gone. Well, this one particular evening, I had a premonition. I knew this is the night I'm going to die. I just knew it. It was just like a word of knowledge. That's what it felt like. If you want to say, what it compared to? Word of knowledge. I just knew it. This is the way it is. I'm going to die tonight. So I stayed up later than the rest of them. I, you know, prolonged it a little bit. Finally went to bed. And I was probably asleep an hour, hour and a half, because this happened around midnight, maybe 12:30. God gave me a dream what was happening or what was supposed to happen to me. And I won't give you the whole thing because it's fairly long and in depth. But part of it, I think, was dream. Part of it was an actual night vision, because I saw the Grim Reaper, the angel of death, the spirit of death. He came for me. And I saw him. I could describe what I saw to you. He came to me to get me, and he was trying to grab me, but he couldn't. I was running away from him in the dream. Let's just call it a dream. I was running away from him, and he could touch me on my back, but he couldn't grab me. It wouldn't stick, but he could touch me. And let's just go with that much of it. I don't want to go in too deep to it. But I could tell in the dream that there was a demonic spiritual being that had come for me. I woke up realizing I was suffocating. Now, this was for real. I woke up now, and I'm suffocating. So I headed to the bathroom, wheezing, trying to get air, and made enough commotion that my brother and his wife woke up. So he came in, and they're standing there. I'm trying to spit this out, cough this out, so I'm leaning over the toilet, trying to get rid of this. And they're standing there watching this, and it wasn't changing. So he came and, you know, pounded on my back, tried to loosen it up a little bit. That did no good. So he just stands back by the door by his wife, and they both have this shocked look on their face. I don't know. It seems like it's when you're in it, you can't tell how long it's going on. But it seemed like it was going on a long time. And when I finally stood up and looked at him, probably with this desperate look on my face, I would imagine, of help me. And he looked at me and he said, he's going to die right in front of us, and there's not a thing we can do about it. And I'm going, oh, great. That's what went through my mind. I was right. I am going to die tonight. My color started changing. I was really close to passing out. And all of a sudden, just like that, it just cleared, and I got air, and I was back. But after having the dream and then having that, I was, as a sophomore in high school, I was freaked out, you know. So I went back to bed. Obviously, I didn't go to sleep. So I was laying there, and I had a record player in my room back when we still did the big vinyls and stuff. So I put on, I was freaked, man. I'm just, the best way to say it, I was freaked, because I had seen the first demon in my lifetime. And it's like, oh, my goodness. So I turned on some Christian songs and a record player, and all of a sudden, the ceiling just disappeared, and I had an open vision of God's spiritual side and things there, and he let me see some things there that just totally took the fear away from me, and I was a total peace. The next thing I knew, I was waking up in the morning, and I'm going, wow. So I almost died. I saw the demonic side, saw the Grim Reaper. I know pretty much, I recognize him if you walk through that door. I can tell you who he was. And I had a vision, open vision, from God's side. All of a sudden, the next day when I woke up, I was an entirely different person. My outlook on life, my personality literally changed that night. The jokester, the goof off, the life of the party was dead. That was gone. All of a sudden, I became very, very black and white in things. What I mean by black and white is it's either right or it's wrong. Let's not mingle them together and make them gray. And this is my experience over my few years of being on this earth. The more of a jokester, partier kind of person you are, the more anything can go, and it's okay. You can mix right with wrong and wrong with right. Nah, it's just having fun anyway, and it's just whatever. And it's just allowed to happen because we're just having fun. The realization of there are two kingdoms, and one is out to kill and steal and destroy. And the other one is our salvation side. And having seen into both and having a glimpse into both, all of a sudden who I was totally changed, and I became very serious in my approach to life. I had encountered the spiritual realm, the evil, hateful, scary side, and then the absolutely awesome side. And to me, life was not a game anymore. That started me down a path that projected into the rest of my life. That's why I say maybe maybe God actually blinded my parents to what I was doing in that 72-hour thing, because God used that to change me forever. And it was a good opportunity. Let's do it. This world is a very spiritual and supernatural place. We are exposed to it via media on an everyday process. Movies, video games, TV, books, magazines, etc. It's right there in front of us, but the average Christian is so desensitized to it, we're not seeing it. We're not recognizing it for what it is. So that launched me on into life, and over especially those first 10, 15 years, of course, this was all new, so stuff happens now, and it's not as shocking to me. But over those first 10, 15 years, up to age 25, 30, out in that area, I have had some very, very real things happen to me because I was aware of the spirit realm, I was seeing the spirit realm, and I was asking for, Paul said, earnestly desire spiritual gifts. Discerning of spirits is one of those spiritual gifts, and I was wanting that. Now that I had seen this and understood, oh, so we can get a handle on this, know what it's all about, I want that. I want to be able to do that. So I have seen a whole lot, and I've seen a lot from God's side. All kinds of miracles have happened in my life. There was a time we were in the mountains ATVing. We had three-wheelers, and we were 2.5 hours from any hospital. We were way back up and in, and kind of exploring, and we came to this huge washout gully kind of thing that, you know, happens. You're out in the wilderness, so it washes out, and nobody there fixes it. And it was probably, 15 feet side to side and 8 feet maybe-ish, 8-9 feet deep. And on the bottom was rocks because the water would run down it if they got heavy rains and stuff. So it was in our way, and we wanted to go across it. So everybody got off. We had all three children. Mary was driving one. I was driving one. We were all kind of just piled on there. So everybody got off, and I got them both to the other side, and that was all good. You go down and just jump it over, and life goes on. Well, then we had to go back. And Jess saw how it happened, you know, the first time when I took him across, and he said, oh, man, that looks like fun. Can I ride with you? And he was a little guy. He was like, 7, 8, maybe. And I had done it, so I knew what it felt like. I said, yeah, that shouldn't be a problem. So he got on with me, and the first time, he was a little bit nervous, scared. So he hung on to me really tight, which that's why it worked, because he was slid forward on the machine. And when you come up the other side, you're coming up like this, you hit the ledge, and then, you know, you've got to have enough forward weight, so it drops down. Well, he was right up tight against me. Worked great. He said, oh, that was great. Can I do it again? Well, Felicia and Eric weren't interested. So, yeah, you can do it again. Well, this time he had done it once. He was braver. So it was operator error on my part. He slid back and sat on the rack holding on the back, which slid him back maybe 1.5 feet from me. Now my center of gravity's off, and I wasn't paying attention. So we go down through that, come up the other side, and we come out the other side, and we're up like this, and it's not going down, and I can't touch the ground because there is no ground. We're just sitting there. I'm going, what is this? Well, he was holding himself forward. I could feel him against me. He was holding himself forward like this, but he couldn't hold himself. So he ended up leaning back. Well, that just brought us back. So we just fell backwards off the top of that back into the ravine. And as we were falling, I can still see him. He was right here with this look on his face like, what just happened? But I thought, if I and the ATV fall on him, this could mess him up. So I was able to get 1 foot kind of touching the side, and I jerked the ATV on me. So I went back with the ATV and the ATV fell on me. Well, when I fell, I hit a rock about that big on the side and broke a rib. So I was in pain. Got up. Mary looked at me. She said, "You okay?" I said, "I think so. I'm hurting a little bit." Got the ATV. I got it out of the ravine, took care of that. And she looked at me and she said, "You better sit down." I was just white. I said, "Okay, I'll sit down, take a break." So I sat down, and that's when I felt blood started gurgling in my left lung. Evidently, the rib broke and punctured my lung. And she said, "What do you need?" I said, "Right now, I need to be alone. So take the kids who are a little bit freaked out, get them away from me right now." And I didn't tell her what the deal was. I said, "Right now, I just need to be alone." Make a long story short, I said, "God, what do I do?" And he brought Psalms 91, and I quoted it and said, "No, we're not doing this." And boom, that thing cleared up, and he must have just evaporated the blood out of her, whatever, because it was filling up on that side. It cleared up. It was good because we were two and a half hours from any hospital. I'd been bad way before we got to hospital. I maybe wouldn't have made a hospital. So miracles like that, broken bones snap back into place and attach. An example, another one that Jess was involved in, he was little, or I think he was like 5 or 6. They were playing across the street with the neighbor children. And they had a little hut they were dealing with there, and they were all over there. And the neighbor boy picked up a piece of log they had there. I don't know why it was there, but picked one up. And he was going to throw it. Well, Jess came running around the corner of the building just as he threw it, caught him here, and broke his collarbone. I mean, it wasn't sticking out of the skin, but it was separate, and you could see the one side pushing up. So I wasn't at home. Mary called me in the office, so I head home. And Jess is laying, when I got home, Jess is laying on the couch sleeping. And I'm going, "Okay, that's not normal. What happened?" So we got in the house, and they had been teaching in children's church about faith and speaking the word and speaking to your mountain. And she said, we got in the house, and he was screaming and crying and wailing, and his brother and sister were moved with compassion. Eric was probably 9, 10 years old, and Felicia in between there. So they started praying over him. They didn't even ask mom. They just started praying over him and doing what they had been taught in children's church. And she said he fell asleep after they prayed. And I said, she said, "We got to take him to the hospital." I said, no, that's not natural. That's supernatural. Let's just let him sleep. She said, "But his collarbone's broken." I saw it's broken. I said, "Let him sleep. We'll see what this is about when he wakes up." And he woke up, and he was very tender. Couldn't move his arm very well, so we made a little sling for him. But it didn't look like it was broken anymore. So I said, you in pain? "Nah, just a little sore, a little stiff and sore." I said, "Cool, we're just going to park on this for a while." So the next day we took him to the doctor, and they x-rayed him. And they said, "Well, I don't know what he did to his shoulder. It can't see any damage. It would appear he broke his collarbone like 6 months ago." Were you aware of that? And it was a Christian doctor. And I wasn't at the appointment. Mary was in with the doctor at the time because you got 3 children. Somebody's got to take care of everybody. And she said, "Well, that happened yesterday." He said, "Oh, my goodness, that's a miracle." He said, "Because that is perfectly in line. The calcium and everything is all built around it." He said, "I would have called that months ago." So it's you know, stuff like that. Supernatural stuff. And I'm just kind of giving you me now so you can understand why I take such a stance on this. Something that happened just a few years back. This was when Jess went to Afghanistan and deployed to Afghanistan, which happened, I believe, when we were working on getting into this building. It was about a year before he actually deployed. He was being told, "We may end up deploying." His outfit didn't know where they were going to deploy to, if they were deploying. He said it's really iffy at this point. We don't know anything. And there are always, every church, every person, everybody has angels assigned to them. And I don't want to freak you out, so I'm not going to go too deep into this story, but I'm just going to stretch you a little bit. This church has angels assigned to it, and there are certain ones that are here all the time. Sometimes I'm able to see them, sometimes I can communicate with them, whatever. Anyway, it was a year before he was deployed. One of them came to me and said, "You're not going to see me anymore for a while." He said, "I am being assigned to Jess when he deploys." And I went home and I told Mary, I said, "Jess is deploying." Well, she didn't want to hear that. I said, "Jess is deploying, and evidently he's going someplace that's halfway dangerous." So why would you say that? I said, "Because if I got this right, this is what was said and da-da-da-da-da, so this angel is now in preparation." Year later, he deployed. He was gone. And I never saw that one again until Jess came back. Then that one showed up again. So it's God's side, the supernatural side, that whole realm, that is, it's just awesome. The demonic side, same thing. I've seen a lot of stuff from the demonic side, and I think there's a whole lot more than the average Christian is supposed to see. And I'm just going to make this statement because I'm starting to build up into taking a stand now. I think there's a lot on the demonic side the average Christian is supposed to see, but we don't want to. We're afraid of it, number one, and number two, we are not desiring spiritual gifts. Because if we were, like Paul said, eagerly desire spiritual gifts, if we desired discerning of spirits, that gift would begin operating in us, and all of a sudden we would be engaged with, there's a lot of people who need freedom, and he would use us to engage with them. But we say, "Well, I've never seen anything like that." Well, yeah, because you don't want to. If you really wanted to be used, or we really wanted to be used to set people free and get them going the right direction, all of a sudden the gifts of the Spirit and the abilities of the Spirit would kick in and you would see these things. It's not that unusual to see them once you're in a position where the Lord says, I'll use you. Like, for instance, let me give you a story. We were in Colorado. There was a young couple that started coming to the church. They came long enough, I don't know what it was, a year, 6 months, a year. They came long enough to feel safe with us, feel comfortable with us. And then one Sunday after service, they pulled us to the side and said, "We don't know what's going on, but can you help us?" I said, "Well, what's the issue?" Their little girl, who was at that point, I believe, 3 or 4. She was, might have been 5 and just a small child. She was definitely in language very well and could understand and comprehend and so forth, but she was still really young. They said, "We moved into a low-income housing unit, and we've been there, and ever since we moved in there, it's just been weird." And they said, "Now for the last number of months, she is seeing things, and something is biting her during the night." I said, "How do you know it's biting her? She dreaminess? She sees sleep? Whatever." He said, "Nope, she's awake." They brought her over. They lifted her shirt, and there were like a human would have grabbed her back. You could see the teeth all over her back. There was bite marks, bruised. Some were black and blue. Some were still red. I said, "When that happened?" They said, "Well, that happened the last couple nights." They said, "What is that?" I said, "Well, that's demonic." So they said, "Can you help us with that?" "Absolutely. Let's go deal with this." So we set a time. I think it was the next day. We set a time, and there was 2-3 of us that went over there. It was myself and Eric and, don't remember. Were you in that one, Dean? Not you? There was 2-3 of us besides myself that went to deal with this. Well, the first thing is, okay, what are you dealing with? You know, what gives this access? So having had some experience in demonic stuff, I said, "Okay, everybody split up. Let's walk through this place. Everybody start praying in the Spirit. And tell me what every room feels like to you." Well, make a long story short, there was an upstairs bedroom where this girl slept in that you'd walk in, it felt okay, but there was a circle in the middle of the floor about that big. You'd walk through it, and you'd literally feel like you walk into an ice box. You just kind of walk through, and it's like, whew. It was a physical feeling. You walked out the other side, and it's like, what in the world was that? So I didn't say anything. Everybody prayed and did, and then we had a little powwow, and I said, "Okay, so what do you guys feel?" And they said, "Everything feels pretty good, but that one room feels creepy." I said, "Okay, let's go to that one room." So we all went in, and inadvertently, everybody was standing in a circle around that spot. So we're praying, and I said, I think it was Eric. I said, come here. And he was across from me. So he walked, and he stepped into that spot, and he went, whoa, what in the world is this? And then I had the others tested. The parents were there. They were a little bit more out of touch spiritually, maybe because they were living in it. You know, you get in the trees, can't see for the forest kind of thing. Well, make a long story short, I asked them, I said, what happened in this room? What are you guys into? Well, we're not into anything. But we heard that the person before us used to sacrifice cats in the apartment. And it's like, okay, so what was that all about? Well, we're not sure, but they replaced the carpet in this room, and they said they saw funny markings on the floor, and there was like a burn spot right here. And they just put a carpet over it and this, that, and the other. Well, what they did is they opened a doorway to the demonic spirit realm side. And this little girl could see them come into the room, and they were just tormenting her and abusing her and et cetera. And we took care of that, fixed it all. It was over. It was done. Life went on. So the demonic spirit realm side is very, very real. There was a person I was dealing with. Some spirits had come up in them, and I was dealing with them, trying to get them out, and they just wouldn't leave. They just wouldn't leave. They wouldn't leave. They wouldn't leave. And this was at a residence where the person was living. And couldn't get them to leave, period. And the Holy Spirit said, they have a connection. There's an open door here. There's a connection. And he told me, he said, ask them what kind of records they have. Vinyl records, music records. Well, they named off a few, and I think one was Black Sabbath, which they were into Satan worship. And I said, we got to get rid of that. Oh, no, we can't get rid of that. That's my favorite record. Well, you want to be free or not? Okay. I said, well, I'm going to take it outside, and I'm going to burn it. I mean, we're going to get rid of it. We're not just going to throw it in the garbage. We're going to go burn it and break the power over it. So I took it outside, and they had some lighter fluid for starting charcoal briquettes kind of thing, and I doused it with lighter fluid and took a match, and I couldn't even get the lighter fluid to light. The lighter fluid would light off of the record, but the record wouldn't burn. So I took authority over that and commanded whatever spirits attached to it, da-da-da-da, go, and all of a sudden, poof, it just lit up and burned, and we got the person free. Another situation had a young lady come to the house who said that she was in trouble because her story was she was being drug out of the house at night by something. And, you know, all the parents are going, yeah, I'm sure that's how you got outside. You got drug outside. And I was very skeptical myself. So talking to the person, I started praying, saying, well, God, you know what this is all about. If this is something that, you know, and started kind of just hitting it a little bit. And all of a sudden, she's up screaming, because we were sitting on the chair. She's up screaming and looks like she's stumbling towards the door. So I went over and grabbed her and said, stop. And she kept being pulled away from me. I said, stop. So I leaned back, pulled her this way. I said, stop. She dug her feet in this way. We're both sliding down the hallway, and there's nobody on the other side of her being pulled towards the door. So, yeah, there must be something there. I mean, this is not natural. This is not the way it's supposed to be happening. You know, in revival stuff, you see all kinds of things. Had one young lady, I think she was still in high school. I haven't seen her decades. Oh, that other one? Can't just drop that? It ended well. You know, it took a little battling, took a little fight, and got the thing to let go, and then we dug into what it was all about, and got her free of it. So it ended well. It wasn't a total I didn't go, ah, well, whatever, I'm going to go get something to eat. You know? It turned out okay. And I could go on with stories after stories. There was this one young lady who got saved in a revival, and she came up to me after service in the prayer line. She said, kind of came from a pagan background, heathen background. She says, is it normal when you're a Christian to come out of your body and float around and be in the congregation? Is this part of a spiritual experience? Yeah, maybe not. So there's a whole bunch of things that I have seen happen. One lady came to me. She was sick. She was dying, losing her health. And all of a sudden, whoop, the spirit pops up in her, is talking out and bragging, you know, how great a job they're doing, and claimed they were killing the lady of cancer, leukemia, specifically leukemia, because that was in the family line, supposedly. I said, I don't believe you. Well, they were arrogant about it, so they named off five generations back, names. Boom, this one died of leukemia, that one died of leukemia, that one died of cancer. That one died of cancer, and went five generations back, said we could go a whole lot further, but there's no point because nobody's going to know anybody who lived back there anyway. Very proud, very arrogant, very whatever. So we prayed and sent the lady home, and her dad was still alive, who, you know, obviously is quite a bit older than her. So I got a hold of him. I said, I just have a curious question for you. I have some names because I wrote the name. They named the names. I wrote the names down. I have a curious question for you. I said, do you know anybody by this name? He said, oh, yeah, that was my sister. What do you mean, was your sister? Well, she died of leukemia when she was X age. I said, really? I said, what about this person? Oh, that was my mother. What did she die of? She died of cancer. And I named all five of them, and he knew all of them in his lineage, and he knew they all died of cancer. I'm going, well, maybe it's true. So, again, to end the story, we worked with the lady, got the thing, got her free of the thing and so forth, and she lived and the cancer went away and everything was fine. So I had all those experiences, and like I had mentioned in that first message, I had a situation where in a deliverance thing, the demon was telling me, I have no right to cast it out. I do not have the right to do this, and the reason was because I celebrate false gods, and I said, I do not. Yes, you do. You celebrate Easter. And I had no clue what Easter was about at that point in my life. And they said, and you also serve Lucifer. And I said, I do not. Yes, you do, because you participate with Halloween. And I'm going, okay, I better check into these two things, like I said in that first message. So to me, the spirit realm, starting as a sophomore in high school, became very, very, very real. And I honestly believe that, you know, different intensities happen with different Christians, but if we would honestly go with Mark 16 and 1 Corinthians 12, all of us would understand the spirit realm so much better, which would make this so much easier to understand. So now let's jump to Halloween. So how does that all tie into Halloween? Halloween is a celebration. It's like Thanksgiving. It's like Easter. It's like Christmas. It's like 4th of July. It's like whatever. Every holiday celebrates something. And to celebrate it, part of the celebration and getting involved with the holiday is the symbolism that goes along with it. If I say fireworks, you think Thanksgiving. If I say big turkey meal, you think Memorial Day. No, because every holiday we celebrate has certain symbolisms that goes with it to identify and perpetuate and increase that holiday. It celebrates something. This is Halloween that we're looking at. So what symbols go through your mind? Well, I knew I was going to be doing this, so last year, I think these pictures came out of Target. I just took four pictures of the Halloween aisle. And what symbols are we celebrating? And you can just kind of pop through them. You don't have to stay long on each one. But everything is death, skeletons, witchcraft. That warning one says unattended children will be captured and used for medical experiments. It's a Halloween sign you put on your house. It's funny, you know, kind of thing. So you've got these pictures. You've got these symbols of the jack-o'-lantern and all this stuff. It's all about Halloween. So, what do those symbols stand for? Everything in those pictures is tied to one thing, death. Everything. Even the little gnomes down below, of course, they get into people's lives and cause problems and eventually kill them. And everything somehow ties to curses, hexes, death. Because curses and hexes are not blessings, by the way. You know, if we say, well, you know, it's just a curse. Curses kill you. That's the design of it. So everything in Halloween stands for ultimately death. You can take it back to one thing, death. So let's look at history a little bit. I'm going to quote some things that come out of this booklet and just give you some history. Where did Halloween begin? It began with the Celtic people, a Druid people. A Druid was a member of an educated professional class among the Celtic peoples of Gaul, the British Isles, and possibly elsewhere during the Iron Age. They were very high affluent people. You should have should have been before that. Maybe it missed it. I'll just read it to you. They were lawyers, speakers, poets, doctors. They were learned professionals. They worked in amongst the religious leaders. They were the ones who came up with the Halloween thing. So here's what it says. The roots of our present Halloween can be traced back to ancient Celtic people. The pagan Druids are historically hailed as the culture in which Halloween celebrations originated. They believed Druids were the ones who were responsible for building Stonehenge. On a yearly basis, the Druids would construct large hollow wicker work statues of usually a human form, if possible. They would fill the human-shaped cage with men, women, and children, and they would sacrifice them. They would set them on fire, and the whole thing would burn. And that's where we get the term, by the way, bonfire, because if you look that word up in Webster and take it back, it's not bonfire, it's bonefire. That's where that comes from. And bonfires are really big Halloween. You'll find out here in a bit why. Some archaeologists believe Stonehenge was erected to calculate the sun's movements and thereby determine the most conducive way or day to worship the Earth Mother Goddess. The date chosen by this method was October 31st. This was the eve of holiday Samhain, or the Lord of the Dead, which was the beginning of the Celtic New Year. So now we're back to the sun god thing. Because they would start they would do this celebration, the sun is waning, and then this is prepped for the rebirth of the sun and that whole thing with Nimrod. Samhain. Now you can go to that next one. I'll read it to you. You can find these online and so forth. Speaking of Samhain or Summer's End, and it's talking about in the top left quarter there, how that two seasons were being brought together here, the summer ending season and winter beginning. And then the bottom left and the top right, it talks about things that people did at that time, bringing the cattle in from the hills because snow would start falling and getting ready for winter, etc. And then the bottom right, it says the Celts believed that at the time of Samhain, who is the Lord of the Dead, more so than any other time of the year, the ghosts of the dead were able to mingle with the living because at Samhain, the souls of those who had died during that previous year traveled to the other world. As a feast of the dead, it was believed the dead could, if they wished, return to the land of the living for this one night to celebrate with their family or their clan. Okay, my iPod decided to lose its spot. Give me a second, I'll be back. There we are. So what they're saying is the celebration of Samhain, or Samhain as it's pronounced in more the English side, is that's the night that everybody who had died previously would travel from the netherworld to a different world, and as they were passing through the veil between the two worlds, could get very thin, and they could cross over into our world and relate with their relatives before they left again, although they were dead. Now you say, well, that's totally ridiculous. No, it's not. I'll give you two scriptural examples of those who have passed on coming into this world and relating with them. One was Elijah and Moses with Jesus. And the other was, when Jesus rose from the dead, it says they saw many people who had died walking around talking to them for a short period of time before they went on into heaven. So we look at that and we say, well, that's just ridiculous. That can never happen. No, that can happen. It can happen. And that would be the demonic side of the other. Here you've got, it's really more intense than we give it credit for. And again, online you find all this stuff because those in Wicca and demonic worship and so forth, they post up there as well as anybody else. This next one's a little picture of a cat, and it says, oh, this blessed Samhain night, do not fear and do not fright, children dressed in ghoulish fun, stay out until the morning sun, spooky tales and candy sweets, we gather from the darkened streets, when the moon is high and the spirits roam, and you are safe inside your Wiccan homes, say a spell to ease their pain, blessed be and blessed Samhain, have a blessed Samhain night. So the spell would be to ease the pain of those who are going from one world to the other. Here's a picture of Samhain, Lord of the Dead. That's none other than Satan, I mean, or one of his close cohorts. Here's another picture, more of a cartoon form of Samhain. And this was kind of interesting. These next four are just, remember your ancestors on Samhain Height, on Samhain Night. Blessed Samhain. You got a witch with, you know, your pumpkins there, and etc. Then the next one was, the wheel has turned, the veil has thinned, blessed Samhain. And you've got a pentagram in the back. And what they're talking about there is the veil between dead and life has thinned so they can cross over for a period of time. That's what they're going back to. The next one would be more modern witches, Samhain blessings. Of course, modern witches are always beautiful. It's just the way they do it. And then it says, this one nauseated me. Have a happy Halloween and a blessed Samhain. Like, and there's the cauldron where they work up their spells and their curses, and it's like, serious? Wow. Well, what's the holiday of Samhain, or Samhain as it was pronounced more on the English side? It was the single most important festival concerning the dead to those who practiced the ancient Celtic religion. It was believed that Samhain, who was the Lord of the Dead, so who is the Lord of the Dead, so to speak? Well, it would be Satan. God is the Lord of the living, so he'd be Lord of the Dead. It was believed that Samhain would call up all the wicked souls that had died during the past year, and with them would come myriads of demons and ghosts who would travel with them. To counter this evil attack, the Druids would sacrifice human children in hopes of placating the evil powers, as well as ensuring fertility for their cattle and crops the next year. They took other steps to protect themselves from the dead, the ghosts, the demons. It was commonly reported that the demons would masquerade as fairies, hobgoblins, vampires, werewolves, etc. Large bonfires were built in remote areas, and they'd build them kind of in a line, and this was done in an effort to attract the dead and their accomplices so they would follow these bonfires, which would give them light, and in so doing, detour the supernatural invaders away from their cities and homes. Just in case some of the night wanderers were distracted from the large bonfires and ended up at people's homes, the people would put food outside of their door of the home because the departed dead and their escorts required food to make their trip to the netherworld. And they discovered that should these evil spirits happen onto a home that has no food outside or no treat was provided for them, the spirits would cast spells on the home. They would then enter the home and cause destruction or play tricks on the family, such as the destruction of crops, cattle, and make people sick, etc. This was the origin of the trick or treat, and that goes all the way back to the Druids centuries before Jesus ever showed up. So when we're walking around saying trick or treat, we're actually, that's what we're saying. We're acting like these spirits or these demons, and that's why we dress up like them. And we go to the door and say trick or treat. And if you don't give me a treat, which nowadays is candy, you know, we could play a trick on you. That's the roots of that. Similarly, jack-o'-lanterns were commonly that we commonly see today were not originally carved from pumpkins. Historically, they were carved from turnips. They were hollowed out with a glowing coal placed inside. And where it comes from is the Druids had a notorious person named Jack who was always getting in trouble, and somehow he tricked the devil into leaving him alone in his human lifetime. But he eventually died, and because he had tricked the devil, hell didn't want him, so he was banned from hell. And because he was a notorious mean man, heaven didn't want him, so he couldn't go to heaven either. So he was forced to roam the earth for his existence, and he was given a coal, an eternally burning coal from hell that he then put in a turnip so it wouldn't burn him, quote unquote. He would just carry it in this turnip, and that would give him light as he wandered the earth, and that is the origins of our jack-o'-lanterns, named after Jack, who needed a lantern, who couldn't go to heaven or hell. Here's one more of these pictures. The veil between the worlds is thin. See, that's that eve where people can cross over. And those of the spirit realm roam the earth tonight. We welcome those who were loved, but the glowing eyes of the jack-o'-lantern frighten others away. Then it says Sam Hain, and it's got down in the left hand, it says Sam Hain and Yule, which ties it back into the sun god. And so it's a big circle. The whole thing is all connected together. So how did it keep perpetuating? Well, as Christianity spread through the pagan areas of the world, a type of compromise was instituted by the Catholic Church in an effort to cleanse the pagan beliefs from the people. The Catholic Church had been celebrating a holiday called All Saints' Day on May 13th. This holiday was to commemorate the deceased saints and martyrs that were held by the church to be as holy. This day was also referred to as All Hallows or Hallows Day. The date of this holiday was changed from May 13th to November 1st. And the reason was so it would coincide with Samhain or Samhain the night before. And the day of, November 1st would have been the day of Samhain or the Lord of the Dead. So they went and grabbed All Saints Day, plopped it on that, which made the eve of All Saints Day or the eve of Samhain the night before that we understand as Halloween. So they joined the two names together and called it All Hallows Eve, or the pronunciation of Samhain with All Hallows Day, Halloween. And the effort was to, again, sanctify this paganism out of Christianity. They took what they considered a godly celebration and plopped it on top of Samhain, or that realm, in an effort to get rid of it and cleanse it up and so forth. Let me quote a little bit to bring it into present day time. Jack Santino, an individual who studied the Celtic people and followed effects of various traditions, he studied them for years. This is a quote from him. Virtually all of our Halloween customs today can be traced back to the ancient Celtic Day of the Dead. And that's what Samhain Day was about. They were celebrating the dead who had died the year before and were now moving to a different place in their eternal existence, and they kind of came through the physical realm to get there. So they were celebrating the Day of the Dead. The wearing of costumes and roaming from door to door demanding, The wearing of costumes and roaming from door to door demanding treats can be traced to the Celtic period in the first few centuries of Christianity, when it was thought that the souls of the dead were out and around along with fairies, witches, and demons. Food and drink were left out to placate them. As the centuries wore on, people began dressing as these dreadful creatures and performing antics in exchange of food and drink. The practice called mumming evolved into our present-day trick-or-treating. To this day, witches, ghosts, and skeleton figures of the dead are among the favorite disguises. Well, those pictures I showed you from, I think it was Target. I don't want to implicate Target, but I think it was Target. I mean, those pictures, that's all it was demons and everything he's talking about, ghosts, witches, skeleton figures. It's celebrating death, Day of the Dead, Samhain. So let me quote on a little bit further. So this stuff is going on. If you go into the demonic worship side or the witchcraft side, this is going on today. This is not something that's quit. In fact, I'll read here in a bit from, let me just read on. So that's going on in that witchcraft side, and we are celebrating it as a party from our side. So you've got two avenues of it happening. It's happening for real. That hasn't gone away in Satan worship and so forth. But on our side, we're celebrating it as a night to have a good time. So let me quote from the Encyclopedia of the Occult, Satanic Bible, as well as the Dictionary of Satanism. I took these quotes right out of there. And I quote, "The present-day belief and practice among witches and warlocks and Satanists is that Halloween is known as Satan's holiday." So I stop quoting and say, okay, so they actually are saying it right in their material. Samhain, that's Satan. Okay, back to quoting. "Known as Satan's holiday, it is on this day that witchcraft has its biggest Sabbath. In the occult world, there are 21 yearly celebrations or holy days, with the most important being Halloween. In the tradition and belief of Satan worship and witchcraft, it is taught that the black cat is a type of animal kingdom with which familiar spirits or demons would inhabit in an effort to live with and be an assistance to human spirits. This tradition is still being heavily practiced in witchcraft circles today. The broom and the broomstick was believed to be a mode of transportation to and from Sabbaths for the human spiritists in ancient times. This would coincide with what we know today as levitation, as well as commonly practiced astral projection. Anton LaVey, the founder of the Satanic Church, or Church of Satan in Los Angeles, in the Satanic Bible, this is what he writes. After one's own birthday, the two major holidays are Walpurgis Night, which takes place around April 30th, welcoming spring, and All Hallows Eve, which takes place October 31st in the onset of winter. The Dictionary of Satanism states, the Druids believed on this night, our present Halloween, that the Lord of Death summoned all the souls of evil people who had been condemned to death to inhabit the bodies of animals. As far as the people involved in witchcraft and Satanism are concerned, Halloween, and this is not a quote now, I'm making a statement in this booklet. Halloween is the most important and festive holidays of the year. It celebrates the beginning of the new year of death and destruction, and is commonly known in the circles, in such circles as Satan's holiday. Now, if I take just that one sentence, now as a Christian, listen to this one sentence. It celebrates the beginning of the new year of death and destruction, and is commonly known in such circles as Satan's holiday. What in the world are we as Christians doing, participating with that? It's totally the opposite of our kingdom. So let me move on and just kind of pull this thing together. We know its origins. We know the symbols. We already went over symbols in one of the other nights we were talking about things. We know how that all works together. Let me just make this statement. There is nothing in Halloween that is godly in any manner whatsoever. Period. And I challenge people all the time, show me something godly in the original celebration of this holiday. There is nothing godly in it. It is celebrating Satan, Samhain, Lord of the Dead, death, destruction, etc. That's what it celebrates. Now, I have a question to go with that. Why aren't we as believers who have the Spirit of God, the Spirit of life, blessing, we know there's angels, we know of the heavenly kingdom, we know of the freedom he bought for us at salvation, and on and on and on we could go, knowing of that realm, of what the Bible tells us of that realm, why are we as believers who have the Spirit in us not nauseated by the symbols that are, just the symbols that are opposite of our kingdom? Not only are they just symbols opposite, they are proclaiming everything that is diametrically opposed to the gospel. I mean, it's 100% the other direction, representing everything that Jesus came to destroy and save us from. How can we not be nauseated just by seeing this, much less celebrating it, once we know? Now, like I said, I used to celebrate it. Everybody's got to claim dumb as a rock at some point in their life. You know, that was me. But once I saw it and saw, now back into my history, saw the absolute opposites of the two kingdoms and the supernatural working of the two kingdoms and how one is out to kill, steal, and destroy and the other one's to give life and saw what Halloween is and which kingdom it falls into? How can you celebrate that? You know, now I wasn't ignorant anymore. Well, I have an opinion of how we can do it. One is, I just gave you, ignorance. You say, but why shouldn't we catch that in the spirit? Yeah, we should. And I think it shows how insensitive to the Holy Spirit we actually are. That we could actually celebrate a holiday that is called Satan's holiday, and when you get into Satanism and witchcraft, it is their high Sabbath to Satan. We can actually get involved in celebrating that, and we don't feel the quench in our spirit. That's how insensitive we are. I mean, what other conclusion can you come to? You know, told you I was going to get a little more solid on this one. We obviously can't be operating in discerning of spirits, because you can discern it. Secondly, we obviously can't be mature enough, like in the book of Hebrews, I believe it's the end of chapter 5, it says that we're supposed to grow and mature and to learn how to discern good from evil. Well, evidently we haven't gotten mature enough to do that one either. Because how in the world can you celebrate evil and call it good and be a mature Christian? Or there's only one way. We're not operating by being led by the Spirit, we're being led by our soul. And making all the kinds of excuses around our emotions and so forth. So let me touch the Christian concept, because this always comes up. Well, but Pastor, we're not celebrating Halloween. You know, we use neutral symbols, and we don't do the trick-or-treating, and we're not celebrating Halloween. We're not involved with the traditions of it, and we're just having a party, we're just having fun, okay? So I just have some simple questions. What night are you having that party on where you're using neutral symbols? Is it on October 31st? Why would you pick that night to have that party where you're using neutral symbols? Why don't you pick any of the other 364 nights of the year to do that if you're not celebrating Halloween? See, that one doesn't add up to me. Are you dressing up for this party? Well, do you dress up for all your parties in the kind of costumes you dress up for this one? You know, for the 4th of July, you wear the same costumes for the 4th of July as you wore for the neutral party you had on October 31st? Probably not. See, so you're celebrating on a night that is absolutely not a night for Christians to celebrate. You're still getting as close to the line as you can in the symbolism. Well, we're using innocent stuff. Well, do you dress your people up for Memorial Day and Labor Day and Thanksgiving? You dress them up then too? Well, no, we don't. So you are celebrating Halloween. You're dressing up just like they do in Halloween. And if you're going to do it on Halloween, no matter how, here's my opinion, no matter how you try to whitewash it, if you're doing it on the night, you're having a party, you're still doing celebrating as far as, oh, we're having a big party tonight and we're just doing neutral stuff. I don't care how you dress up a pig, it's still a pig. Underneath it all, you take the clothes off, it's still a pig. And here's my thing to the, well, but we're doing neutral things. The fact that you're doing neutral costumes or accessories, or you're trying to stay neutral on some of the traditions, simply reinforces the fact you already know Halloween's wrong and you're trying to sanctify it. That's all it tells me. Well, yeah, it probably wouldn't be good to do that. So we're going to do this. So you already know it's wrong. But we're going to redeem it or sanctify something. You can't sanctify this. There's nothing in this celebration that is godly at all. You can't sanctify it. I told you I was pretty black and white on this. So let's look at the four principles we've been applying to all these holidays. Number one, is there any direct scriptural input or commands? In this case, absolutely. This holiday is directly representing and is in celebration of the demonic realm and Satan, period. There is nothing godly in this celebration, this holiday. Principle number two, are there any redeemable qualities in it that we could redeem out and use to celebrate? If there is, could you show me them? That's always my challenge. And you know, I'm going to make a statement right here. Of the stance I take on different holidays, the one that seems to aggravate Christians the most is this one. I catch the most flack for this one. You are just a legalistic, hard-nosed, you don't have fun. What about our children? They're not going to have fun. Just show me one part of this thing that is godly. Yeah. I had one person tell me this. Well, but the kids are having fun. Fun is godly. I said, there's people out in the back seat who aren't married having fun too. Is that godly? Yeah. Sin is fun for a season. The Bible says that. I mean, how deep into the bottom of the barrel do we have to scratch to try to defend our sin? I mean, come on. My mind is there's nothing redeemable in this holiday. Name one thing that's right with this holiday in God's sight. Because here's what Christians usually say. Well, I don't see anything wrong with it. Well, show me something right with it. We don't live by, well, I don't see anything wrong. We're supposed to compare to righteousness, not sinfulness. Well, I'm not as sinful as some people. Well, does that make you righteous? You know, they're worse than me. Well, you're both bad. So they get two stars, you get one. I mean, hello. We're supposed to be comparing to righteousness, not sinfulness. Number three, if it's big in the world, take a second look. That comes out of 1 John 2:15-17. Well, when you look at it in the store, you look at it online, you look at it any place that shows Halloween, what are the symbolism? What are we seeing? You know, when you look at it, take a second look. If you honestly took a second look, honestly, it's like, this thing is full of death. This thing is the opposite of our kingdom. And number four, what spiritual force is promoting it? 1 Corinthians 10:1-33, talking about communing with demons, taking communion with them, idol worship, that whole thing. I mean, you talk about communing with demons. This holiday gives you full opportunity, especially if you get involved with the traditional end of it. But I mean, you talk about, are you trying to tick God off? What are we doing? So once I came to the realization of what this is all about, that serious black-white side of me kicked in. I've seen enough of both sides of the spirit realm to know that this one is not an innocent holiday. Everything he symbolizes is opposite of God and his kingdom. So if it's opposite of God and his kingdom, whose kingdom are we celebrating? Whose kingdom are we promoting? So why do we as Christians do it? Well, sometimes it's ignorance, but I think we're just that out of touch. Now, I'm going to give you some comparisons here right out of Scripture that might shock you a little bit, but this is how I see this. Personally, I see this as a loyalty or an adultery issue. This is adultery. This is where I'm coming from on this. This is equivalent to sleeping with your fiancé's enemy while you're engaged to be married. It is the same thing. You say, well, how can it be the same thing? We are betrothed, Paul says, to one who is Christ. And Paul said, I am watching over you and guarding you with jealousy so you would be presented as a virgin to Christ. Christ's arch enemy is Satan and everything of that kingdom. So while we're going to get married with him, we go over here and we celebrate death, destruction, Satan's holiday. Spiritually, what is that? That's adultery. Spiritually, that's adultery. How would your fiance feel? You're engaged to be married, and their worst enemy, you go sleep with them. Well, let's not get so serious, Pastor. Okay, let's back up. You just go party with them.
No.
Your fiance's worst enemy. You just go party with them. Hang out with them. What would your fiance feel like? That's what Jesus feels like. That's what Jesus feels like when we do this thing with Halloween. Because again, I restate, this holiday has nothing godly in it. It is totally formed around Christ's arch enemy. Why would we celebrate that enemy? Everything that Jesus came to steal, I mean, to get rid of via his life, his death, his resurrection, is being celebrated at Halloween. Why would we do that? So I got a couple of scriptures here for you. He who does what is sinful is of the devil, because the devil has been sinning from the beginning. The reason the Son of God appeared, here's the part I want to show you. The reason the Son of God appeared was to destroy the devil's work. That was the reason he came. Why would we celebrate that as being something good when he came to destroy it? What in Halloween pictures God's work? Nothing. So what are we celebrating? The devil's work. The very thing he came to destroy, we're celebrating. James chapter 4. You adulterous people. So now he's calling this a spiritual adultery. Don't you know that friendship with the world is hatred toward God? Anyone who chooses to be a friend of the world becomes an enemy of God. Or do you think Scripture says without reason that the Spirit he caused to live in us envies intensely? Now put that back into that fiancé sleeping with the enemy situation. Don't you understand that sleeping with the enemy of Christ is becoming a friend? It's friendship with that. Anyone who chooses to be a friend of that is an enemy of God. That's why the Spirit causes or is so intensely jealous over us in this thing, because it's like taking, I know I'm engaged to Jesus, we're going to be married someday, but I want to go spend time with his arch enemy and sleep with him. This is spiritual adultery, is what it is. This scripture he doesn't have, I just added this one, so I'll just read it to you. It's 2 Timothy 3, 1 through 5, probably everybody knows it. It says, the godlessness of the last days, and the last days mark this, their terrible times will be. Verse number 4, lovers of pleasure rather than lovers of God. That's a trademark or an insignia of the last days. Serious. When you come with the thought of, well, we wouldn't want to deprive our children of having fun. Are you serious? You love pleasure that much that you're willing to go commit spiritual adultery to have fun rather than loving God and staying committed to him? Serious? It's a sign of the last days. And it's why so many Christians can do it and they don't even flinch, because we're in the last days. Just saying it. So the bottom line is, you're going to have to decide for yourself. Again, I can't legislate this. It's not my job. It's not my spot. But now you know. Now you know. So the cat's out of the bag. Hopefully it's not full of demons and familiar spirits like they believe in witchcraft. The cat, black cat, you know, thing. Now we've exposed the whole thing. And now you're going to have to decide. From my perspective, there is nothing redeemable in this. This needs to be crucified. And I've said it before and I say it again. At some point, you have to teach your children to say no to ungodliness. At some point, we have to teach them this. Well, but they're going to lose their friends if they don't go out and get drunk with them. And if they're not having sex like the rest of the girls do, they're not going to be popular. And blah. At some point, we have to say no to sin. Mm-hmm. Yep. If we don't learn that as adults, we're going to be a train wreck. That will be continually happening. There is a lot of things that are fun that I will not do as an adult because the end of that train track is ugly. It's ugly. You got to say no. Your flesh might like it. Your soul might even want to go there for a while and get intrigued with the temptation. But you got to say no. When are we going to teach our children that? Here's a perfect opportunity. There's just some things you don't do. If you're going to be betrothed or engaged to Christ and you're going to be loyal to Him, there's just some things you say no to. You don't sleep with the best man the night before the wedding. That's just, you know. And of course, in this situation, it ain't even the best man. This is the enemy of the groom. You just don't go there. So, there it is. There's my load. I set it, put it out there. Hope you still love me.